Rutkin, Eutonic, Papadakis, Onez, Thomas, Hyderion, Rogan, Darwin, Isa.
All right, everybody. Have a dab and welcome to the Ancient Civilizations and Cultures of Anatolia lecture here, prepared and presented by my good friend TK Sivgin and co-presented and somewhat interrupted and interjected by yours truly, CM Kozeman. If you are here today, chances are you are maybe living in Turkey or are interested in the past history of Anatolia. When I say past history, I'm talking about the ages of Anatolia before Rome and Byzantium and the Ottomans. So this is a highly popular region of the world, and it has always been so, and it will probably keep on being so. And it should not surprise us that certain debates about who is who or what is what in Turkey are kind of problematic, to say the least.
Yeah, let me just change to this slide.
Yeah, so when you're commenting, please just, you know, hold back, like, listen a bit and, like, you know, kind of factor everything in, you know, don't have a sword to sharpen, but only your thoughts to polish. And also consider supporting TK Sivgin on his Patreon and me, CM Kozeman, on my Patreon. We are embarking on a big project here. I don't think anything quite like this exists on YouTube. So, like, great accolades to you, TK. And without much ado, take it away.
Thank you. So, yeah, like, why did I want to talk about this? And I kind of just want to make people realize something that has been revealed by recent genetic studies, which, I mean, it does sound a bit bad now that I think about it, but you see, like, many Turks and many non-Turks even think that the modern Turkish population are recent invaders that just displaced everyone.
Yeah.
So, like, one day you have Byzantines living there, the next day everything just deleted and replaced with Turks from Central Asia.
Yeah, yeah. And there are also, like, some, let us say, exaggerated that go along with this too.
Memo, don't talk about that.
Okay.
We're talking about, okay, like, that is recent history. That is a whole different topic. We are talking about really ancient history today.
Okay. So, I broke my own rule, in slide one.
Yeah, like, literally, like, this is... Yeah, that it's a whole topic for another day. And let's just say really, really bad things have happened recently. But this will not affect what we will talk about today.
Okay, so sorry.
So what I just wanted to say is... that many genetic studies have recently come out which show that Turks are really not that different from all of their neighbors. We're not really that different from Armenians, from Lebanese, from Greeks.
Yeah, and yeah.
What I found the most intriguing is that these studies found that there is actually, like, a common thread in all of these populations that dates back all the way to Bronze Age populations.
Hmm.
And...
so,
and, yeah, but that to me tells is that even though languages, religion, and ruling classes have changed, the common people have largely stayed the same.
Uh-huh. So, let me get this right. Like, everybody's great-great-granddaddies came together during the Bronze Age. Is that right?
Yeah, Bronze Age, maybe even earlier than that. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, you cannot with every country trace the history of the population all the way back to like the Paleolithic.
Uh-huh.
But you can still find like people today who have some genes from a person that lived in the same village 1,000 years ago. That in pretty much every country, actually. Like there was in Great Britain, there was this case where they found this human fossil called Cheddar Man.
Mm-hmm.
And they found out that right in the next village, there was a guy who was genetically related to that.
Oh, yeah.
In England. And you have so many cases like that in every country. Like Egypt, I think, is also a very prominent example where many people today say the modern Egyptians, they're not the same as the ancient Egyptians. They're mm-hmm. Arabs, which is true on a language basis, but if you look at the demographic changes at genetic studies and such, it shows that modern Egyptians are largely descended from the ancient Egyptians still.
Yeah, yeah. So this is very interesting. And this has been what led you to an in-depth study of ancient Anatolian history, basically.
Yeah, basically. I just wanted to make Turks, and maybe also, of course, other people, more interested in these people that are, in my perception, often disregarded because it's perceived that they were not ancestors of Turks.
Well, it's very interesting because let me give you a little side note from the history of Turkish education historical narratives. In the 1990s, school children were still made to study the ancient Hittites, Phrygians, even Urartu people and like Lydians and all the peoples of the ancient region, basically. And the reason for this curriculum choice was this one very eclectic theory stating that it's complete irredentism, of course, but basically they believe that the ancestral Turks something like 20,000 years ago colonized Anatolia, but they were made to forget their origins due to like historic effects of Byzantium and Ottomans or whatever. This is like a very fringe nationalist theory that somehow made it to the school curriculum.
We are not endorsing that today. Like, of course, there is a strong Central Asian element in modern Turks that came from in recent history.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So this theory, this not even a theory, this like extreme hypothesis postulated that actually when the Turks came to Anatolia with the Battle of Manzikert, this was actually a reconquest and they were like reawakening their ancient heritage, which had already been here in the shapes of the Hittites and all the rest, a bit like Necrons maybe even in Warhammer lore, but... So it's just one interesting side note.
It's funny that you mentioned Warhammer because the Emperor of Mankind was born in Turkey.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, but like I said, we are not endorsing that theory. The theory I am endorsing here is that when the Seljuks came to Turkey, they just fucked with everyone.
Yeah, it looks like it was just a very like small cadre of like 100, a few hundred extremely professional generals and leaders. And, you know, they were just busy at organizing stuff. And, you know, when you're successful, you kind of spread your genes around a bit, I guess.
Yeah. And you've entered in the history of so many other countries. And So all I want to say is, to any Turkish viewers, there are reasons. Like, even if these cultures were not related to us in any way, they are still very, very interesting to look at just from the, from the culture, from the architecture, from the religion.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So let's set the context. What is this area we call Anatolia? Like, often it's classic, like, can you see my mouse pointer?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, like often it's just like this area, but sometimes it's stretched all the way to the Caspian Sea to include where today is Armenia and mm-hmm. Azerbaijan and regions of Iran. I don't want to make like any precise definition of that today. We'll just talk about this general area here. Maybe even yeah. also of northern Syria, because Hatay extends into here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You kind of know it when you see it.
So, and of course, it's really insane to think about how central this area of land has been to the history of the world, because you see here you have Mesopotamia, where civilization, as you know, it was basically born. Mm-hmm. Then you have the Levant, where so many important religious developments happened, a little mm-hmm. south here is Mecca. Then you have Greece right here, where so much philosophical work has been done.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then you have the steppes of Asia.
Mm-hmm.
And just a little down here is, of course, also Egypt, which is basically the oldest country in the world.
Yep.
And then you also have ancient Persia here, and then Central Asia, and just a little far off here is where historic India would start. And yeah, you see, like, Anatolia has been smack dab in the middle of all of this, and mm-hmm. it really, really shows in the history. Like, you have so many bizarre combinations show up over the centuries. For example, you know, Galatasaray is named after a tribe of Celtic people that came Whoa. All the way from here over the Bosporus and then settled in central Turkey and then started writing with a Greek alphabet. And it's
Celts. Interesting.
Yeah, Celts. The Galatians.
Is that why they have the red and yellow colors? I'm just going to like crack a stupid joke.
I don't know. I don't know. We won't talk today about the Galatians because they're an Iron Age culture, and I think we will be lucky today if we even get to the Bronze Age today.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, so like that's the context. I want to say everything in like Asia Minor has always been in flux. There were people coming from the west, from the east, from the north, from the south, and everyone left a little trace of themselves here.
You could argue it's already happening today, right? With all these refugees from the wars in the region.
It's always been happening. There is always constant migration everywhere in the world.
Yes. So that's another thing to consider. I mean, in this day and age, and we are recording in October 2023, and, you know, just at the time of recording, a new big war seems to be erupting in the Middle East. And, you know, guess where those people are going to go?
Memo.
Yeah, yeah, okay, but I'm being civil. I'll just quote the amazing quote that's on the Statue of Liberty in the United States, which is, "Give me your cold, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to be free." Anyways.
Yeah, okay, well said.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Yeah, I also want to give you some, like, historic names of the region. Like, the oldest known name for this region that we know of is Hatti, which comes from the Bronze Age Hattian people, and we don't really know what that means. It was just the name these people either gave themselves or were given by other people.
Mm-hmm.
And in classical times, the Greeks called this area Asia. And mm-hmm. then when the word Asia was extended to all of this here, all the way to China, they had to specify that this is Asia Minor. And this region is, in German, this region is still called Kleinasien because of that. Mm-hmm. So Little Asia.
Yeah, yeah.
And we don't, it's not, the etymology of the word Asia is also debatable. There are some ideas that it comes from the Sumerian word for east, but that doesn't mm-hmm. make much sense because the Sumerians lived here in Mesopotamia, so Anatolia for them would have been in the northwest.
Yep, yep.
There is another possibility, and we will get to that later. Then, yes?
All right.
And then in Greek and then Byzantine times, it was called Anatole, which is the Greek word for the east.
Yep.
And then when the Seljuks and Turks and everyone showed up here, they called this area Rome, basically, because the Byzantines, they did not call themselves Byzantines, they called themselves Romans.
Romoi. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, because they were still the technical inheritors of the Roman Empire.
Exactly.
And then, ironically, the area was then later named after the Turks during Ottoman times. Like many European powers called this area Turchia.
Mm.
And the funny thing about this is that the Ottomans would not have called the country that name, because Turk for a long time was a bit of a derisive word for like nomads.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, well, yeah, yeah. It's a bit like the contempt felt by coast living Americans towards people in their heartland in a weird way.
Mm-hmm.
Can I also interject and like tell about this legend used to explain the name in, once again, post-1980 dark Turkish nationalistic education curriculums? So I remember distinctly, and this is very civil, so there's nothing like weird about it, but the teacher set us aside one day and gave us this like study sheet. And it was all about, why do we call this homeland of ours Anadolu, Anatolia? And it was like the most interesting story. So apparently after the Battle of Manzikert, Alparslan's armies were like very thirsty, you know, like they were just, you know, they just fought a big battle, conquered half of a subcontinent. So as you would, they were very thirsty. They were just walking around, I guess, saying like, boy, I wish there was something to drink. It's like suburban kids playing in the front yard or something. And lo and behold, they came to an age-old fountain. And by that age-old fountain, there was a very old and wise-looking mammy figure, like a grandma almost. And she had with her a kind of like magical-looking almost vessel, something like an amphora. And she kept filling the amphora with the water from the fountain. And she actually somehow magically produced enough water to satiate the thirst of the entire Seljukid army. And then the Seljuk bros were like, Anadolu, Anadolu, tamam, yeter, Anadolu. It was like, so like a translator's note here, Anadolu also, Anadolu in Turkish, ana means mother, dolu also means full. So there was this wordplay that they were saying, okay, mama, mama, it's full. Okay, I don't need anymore. But, you know, she was like a caring and giving mama. She was like, oh, no, son, have some more. And then magically she solved the logistics needs of the entire Seljukid army. And they were saying, Anadolu, Anadolu. And that's how this land of ours was called Anadolu, according to this crazy modern legend.
Yeah, that's like these like post hoc etymologies. They remind me a lot of European stories too, where people don't know where a name comes from, so they just invent something.
Yeah, yeah.
Like
Everybody does it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, you see the original Latin name of Zurich, where I live close to, is Turicum. And it's not really known what Turicum means. And so some guy, I think in the 1800s, hypothesized that where the city once stood was once a Roman colony with tall towers, you know, Turris.
And that. Okay.
There definitely was not. Like, Turicum during Roman times would have just been like a garrison that was like ringed by a Celtic village.
Yeah.
And you see stories like that everywhere before the advent of modern linguistics and archaeology.
Nothing new under the sun.
Yeah.
All right.
Also, what name do you think this area will have in the future? I left this blank on purpose.
I think they will still keep calling it Turkey or Turkiye in the next century or something.
in the next decades, maybe, but think really far in the future, like 3000 AD.
Well, I don't know. Habadab. Who knows? I mean, that far ahead.
Yeah, maybe, you know, like I said, the Emperor of Mankind from Warhammer, he was born somewhere here. Maybe you are him and this will be called Memonistan.
Oh, like even if I had such power, I don't think I would name a place after myself.
Yeah, it's but just like the people name it after you. That's the thing. You cannot control that.
Okay.
You have all power in the world, but you cannot control people's minds.
Well, so, what if you are the Emperor of Man? You come back and they call it Sivginia. That's a very poetic name.
I wasn't born in Turkey.
Ah. Anyways, jokes aside.
And yeah, let's start with the history, like, or better, the prehistory. There is surprisingly little from the Paleolithic, which, it surprises me a bit, because we know from some bones in Georgia that Homo had already reached this area in the Middle East around 1.8 million years ago. So before that time, there probably were already Homo erectus and maybe even Australopithecines running around in this area.
Yeah. I mean, you have fossils of several like pre-Australopithecine apes. Like, there's even one genus that's specifically known from Ankara called Ankarapithecus. So it would make sense.
They recently discovered that, right?
Sorry?
They recently discovered that, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's quite recent. So it only makes sense, I think, for what you say to be true. Maybe somehow where they lived was not prone to fossilization, like the specific habitats they lived in. Who knows?
Yeah, I mean, it is a very dry. It has always been a very dry savanna area, which bones there often get trampled on by larger animals or just eaten by vultures and or just dissolved by the elements. And so, yeah, it is not that conducive to fossilization.
Yeah.
Regardless, this area probably would have been very interesting in the development of humans and also how we spread from Asia, from Africa into the rest of the world. Because, like I said, it is the bridge between Asia and Europe. And some hominid, especially if it is true that some like Homo erectus are already capable of building boats, they probably did use these straits to cross from Asia into Europe.
Yeah, maybe even at times if it was frozen, like in certain winters, it could have provided a natural bridge for them to cross over.
Well, probably not frozen, but because of the glaciation in northern Europe, the sea levels sunk. So some of these areas probably were dried up.
Oh, no, not like directly frozen, but even as recently as the 1950s, there were very cold winters in which pack ice clogged the Bosphorus and people could walk across.
Yeah.
Anyways, a side note.
So the first definitive like signs of human activity come from Geddes River, where they have found some primitive quartzite flakes that were probably made by some Homo erectus type human.
Yeah.
And then in areas like Yarimburgas cave and Kula caves, we find the first signs of Homo sapiens. That about, let's say 100,000 years ago, or maybe even younger.
Was Yarimburgas the cave that was close to Istanbul?
I believe so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's not many interesting things from Paleolithic, but once we go into the Mesolithic and Neolithic, things get really, really interesting, because you suddenly find around 10,000 BCE, you have all of these megalithic sites in eastern Anatolia, like in this area close to Mesopotamia. And yeah, these are just absolutely amazing. They are among the oldest megalithic structures on the planet. And they are, for the age they were made in, they are highly sophisticated. And
yeah,
put into perspective how far back these things were made, it is widely thought that the people who made this did not even know farming yet. These were still hunter-gatherers that just happened to live in a very fertile valley where they could find enough food in nature to settle down.
That's fascinating. And it's crazy how recent this is. I think like in the 1990s, before that, nobody knew about this whole thing, right?
Yes. Yes, I think some archaeologists noted about these sites in the 60s already, but it wasn't realized how old these are until a few decades ago.
And I think you're going to get to there, but these certainly were not the only sites. And it looks like the whole region was covered with, like, basically murder temples like these ones.
Yeah, I'll talk about two, actually, like Karahan Tepe and the more famous Göbekli Tepe. But Karahan Tepe is interesting because it is older. Mm-hmm. So we see like some things that later show up in Göbekli Tepe, but in a more early state.
Yep.
And yeah, about the artwork and so like what were these structures actually? There is a lot of visual artwork at these sites that largely depicts male animals. So like every mammal you see depicted has a very prominent penis.
Mm-hmm.
And also you see a lot of phallic imagery and very disturbingly headless humans a lot.
Yeah, I kind of know that there was a particularly bloody skull cult here. But I don't want to rush in too much because I think you have slides about that coming up.
To that.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I will debate you on that. And there is also like strong reverence to certain totem animals. Of course, like biodiversity back then was much larger. So you also had like leopards and vultures and all sorts of subtropical animals living in Turkey. Mm-hmm. It is interesting that at these sites you don't find any visual artwork of invented creatures, no mythical creatures or deities even. It's just
blended creatures like the lion man you have in Europe, right?
Yeah, no chimeras, no gods, no monsters, just humans and animals. So the things that these people directly interacted with in nature.
But could it be because we just haven't found them yet? And maybe there are some lurking in there. Who knows?
Maybe. But yeah, we don't. So far, I mean, a lot of it has been excavated, especially in Göbekli Tepe.
Mm-hmm.
So I would be surprised if we found it again. But again, like you said, it's the sort of like black swan, white swan problem.
Yeah.
You can always think that something is the case, and then tomorrow something can just come along and disprove everything.
Yeah. Yep.
And of course, like, what were these things used for? Because of all the phallic imagery, there are some ideas that these were like temples for fertility rites.
Mm-hmm.
Because the vultures and all the predatory animals, there was this idea that this could have been these open air graves, which some religions today still have, like Zoroastrians, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You put the dead out in the open so that scavenger birds and other animals can come and cleanse the bones from the flesh.
Yep.
Then, of course, like you said, there is possibility that there was a skull cult here. Or it's also with the here. It's also possible that these were settlements. There is this growing trend among archaeologists where they hypothesize that there actually was a roof over this entire thing and that this was a large house. Hello?
That's very interesting. Can you hear me?
I got scared that the connection broke.
Oh, no. So like a larder, like a kind of,
yes,
almost like That's very interesting, and yeah. It kind of does make sense with the roof over it, though.
Yes. And now here is the penis room at Karahan Tepe. That's what the archaeologists actually call it. Because they interpret these pillars as being phallic, which you don't see it well in this image, but I guess from other angles it becomes more obvious.
But wouldn't it be kind of not like a penis if there was a roof over these? It would just be like, I don't know.
Well,
I'm not an archaeologist, so I don't want to make any bold claims.
The artwork I showed was like a speculation about Göbekli Tepe. We don't know if that was also the case at Karahan Tepe.
Mm-hmm.
Here's satellite imagery of the site, and you see here these are water channels that were carved by these people. So maybe this was some sort of pool.
Yeah.
So that maybe these structures were there to gather rainwater.
Your guess is as good as mine.
Yeah.
It looks like they kind of figured out building and then just had like almost like a Minecraft time at it. Like, oh, here's a room, here's another room. Oh, I can also carve stones to look like people. Whoa, let's do some more of that. It looks like whoever did this really had this kind of like no holds barred kind of creative relish with this technique. So there's my 5 cents of contribution to the Göbekli Tepe discourse.
I mean, you wouldn't be wrong in that assumption. Like, as soon as something new is discovered, people experiment first before they become focused on a specific practice.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Then they also found these stone heads, which they remind me a lot of like these Polynesian tiki figures.
Exactly. I'm sure there's at least one crank researcher out there who's going to link the two, by the way.
I mean, don't you remember that? Atatürk didn't believe this, right? But he did have books about this theory that Turks and the civilization of Mu were somehow linked.
Sure, yeah. So this is where the Mu seafarers landed anyways.
Oh, God. Yeah, dear crackpot theorists listening to this video, if you ever get successful with your theories, please.
Also like, comment, and click the bell icon. So at least we have more subscribers.
Yeah, and check out Memo's OnlyFans.
Ooh. You don't give that out, man.
Come on, the people have to see it. You can't hold back perfection.
Well, I don't know. With the state of our economy, it may come to that. I don't know.
The people deserve it. And so here is another view of this site at Karahan Tepe, and you see these very characteristic T-shaped steels.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, here, like I said, there's many statues of headless humans, and you don't see it up close well because it looks like it's fused to the torso, but this area here is actually meant to be the penis.
Oh!
Holding a magnum dong all the way up to his chest.
Oh, wow. Okay, these guys really were really proud about themselves. Let me say that much. I mean, interesting.
These sites really celebrated masculinity, and there is almost like no visual depictions of female beings.
Well, you know, in a lot of cave art also, you have like a really high prevalence of schlong guys, to say the least. So maybe it's like a kind of archaic impulse, like when you start to create something, of course, creativity in guys is closely related to, I think, sexuality, sexual repression, or I don't know, like trauma, basically. So it's not surprising for things like this to happen in a variety of cultures, like in almost all of ancient cave art or petroglyphs, you see figures like this, like big guys with big dicks, basically. So
yeah, I mean, it could also just be for the lols. Maybe they
could be.
Like, we find genitals universally funnier, I think.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, not everything in the past has to be like a kind of like sacred and like kind of like arcane. And I really guess a lot of old archaeological relics were just the equivalent for shit posting in their days. But I'm not able to say which is which.
Yeah. Although, like, when you carve out a big statue like that, it probably is more than a joke.
Yeah.
But here, we come to the big one, Göbekli Tepe.
Mm-hmm.
Very beautiful. Like, here's the whole view. It's actually quite big.
Yeah. Tell you what, these square shapes, they are an artifact of the archaeologists digging, right?
I believe so, yes. They probably made a grid system out of it.
Yeah. Because I don't think it's likely that the Göbekli Tepe built like in grids yet.
Yeah, it's these round forms that this culture was developing. And I think a lot of early cultures had like round houses, round buildings. And like the idea of squares was invented later.
Yeah. It looks like those relics in Ridley Scott's Prometheus and the other film, basically.
Yeah.
And as faulty as those films were, they really had this sense of archaeological wonder in their opening acts when these people were exploring these alien worlds. And
yeah, because they fully went with the ancient aliens theories, which...
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't want to talk about this, but yeah, there is also ancient aliens theories about Göbekli Tepe, because how could Stone Age people have built this and such? And it's just a bunch of rocks, guys. It's not that complicated, really.
Yeah, also, like, when you have no distractions, it's amazing what people can build. Like,
yeah, these people, like, today the area is very arid, but in the Stone Age, this was a very fertile valley with a lot of game animals and a lot of wild eatable plants. Could afford to settle here for at least a part of the year and build this for whatever reason they needed. And like you said, maybe this was actually a larder. And yeah, actually, now that I think about it, you could be right. This could have been a larder, and maybe all the artwork of like decapitated humans and ferocious animals, maybe that was just to ward off thieves or evil spirits.
I mean, it would make sense. I think maybe it's a kind of mixture between a food storage and like a throne room. So like, you kill everything, you stash them, and then spend some weeks and months eating them. And, you know, when you're full, you kind of relax, you make some art on the walls. And then when you're hungry, you go out shopping again. So, I mean, maybe everything is hypotheses at this point. But take what I'm saying with a grain of salt. But doesn't seem unlikely from judging from what we now know.
Yeah. Now, here's some animal art from the site. It has like this, both a very simplistic and yet very beautiful quality to it.
Yeah, this is fantastic. Which one is your favorite?
I think the birds in the middle. It's just kind of cute.
Yeah, I'm torn between the birds and the strange crocodile creature on the right.
That's probably meant to be a leopard.
Oh, even the thing on the... Yeah, it's either a leopard or a wolf on the lower right. Yeah.
No, the lower right, I think that's identified as a fox by the archaeologists.
Ooh, okay.
You can see the pieces. Yeah, here's some more art. I think this is like the only 3D figurine that was found on one of the pillars.
Yeah.
Probably also of a leopard, but it has like a very skeletal quality to it.
What are those things that look like handbags up top?
These?
Yeah.
Huh. I don't know.
Do you think they could be a representation of these people's own spaces with the like roofs over them? Who knows?
Could be, yes. And like you said, this is called the Vulture Stone. And like you, before you asked if there were like any representations of like animal-headed humans, and this kind of looks like it could have been that, but maybe it's just a bad representation of a vulture.
Yeah, and what's the ball? Is it the sun? Nobody knows. But here's what I'm saying. Like, I think it was a distinct choice that these people didn't have any hybrids. I mean, they could very well make, because they have many abstract patterns. Mm-hmm. And it's crazy how efficiently they cross between like realism and stylization. So like, it personally seems to me that if they wanted to make mixed creatures, they very well could. They just didn't want to in this case.
Yeah, you're right, because some like these ferrocephalic deity figures are older than Göbekli Tepe. There's like this lion man statuette from Germany that is like 50,000 years old.
Yeah, so it's supremely interesting though.
Mm-hmm. And like you said, stylization, some of these pillars have actually been identified as being representations of large humans. So like this thing you see, it's not, you don't see it well in this picture, but these are meant to be arms, and this area is like loincloth. So this is like a very abstract representation of a human with this T shape maybe being the head.
It's just fantastic. I mean, do you think these were also painted in life somehow?
Maybe there is a good possibility they maybe were, but the color could have just worn down over the eons.
It's just, I mean, like, you keep trying and trying, and it's like such a fantastic mystery. Like, here is the evidence, and it's like gigantic, yet you still can't put it into context, and it just keeps the noggin jogging, as I like to say.
Yes. And now we come to the thing that you talked about today. Like, we don't know about any burials at Göbekli Tepe. There are, I think, some at Karahan Tepe. Mm-hmm. But what we did find here is fragments of human skulls that have very obviously been carved with tools. And here I paraphrase you. You think some sick cannibal shit was going on here and aliens should have nuked the place?
Yes, I am on record for saying that in my Göbekli Tepe video in my channel, yeah.
And I actually read some papers on what archaeologists think about these fragments, and they have found no sign that this was like an act of scalping or that these skulls were carved when the human was still alive, but he was already dead. There's also no signs of cannibalism and such. And instead, what these carvings were made for is probably hanging cords and ropes around them so they could be hung from somewhere, or maybe even be worn. And
I don't know.
You can interpret this in a sinister way, but what I think this was is a way of keeping family around after death.
Ah, okay.
Like, grandpa died and you don't want to, you miss him, and you just keep his head with you. It sounds morbid to us today, but there are still some cultures that do stuff like that.
Yeah, in Papua, there are cultures who have like their dead buried in like little caves on hills, and they're still looking over at the village.
Yeah, or in Indonesia, there is an island where there is a holiday where they just dig up their relatives from the graves and have them participate in the festivities.
Okay. So, I mean, of course, I was just like tongue-in-cheek joking when I said that, so I wouldn't know. But it also, I'll still like, yeah, I mean, on one hand, would you really want to have your enemies around like that? But maybe you would, because like,
enemies?
Yeah, like, no, like, I still have a part of me thinks these were like their enemies hung up there to like, as an example, basically. Like
I have a counter to that, which mm-hmm. is that in none of the artwork at Göbekli Tepe and Karan Tepe do you see actually violence happening.
People
did not make artwork of violence happening, which they could have. We know many Neolithic sites where violence is shown. For example, in the Nakada culture in Egypt, there's all these reliefs where they show these proto-pharaohs smiting prisoners with their maces and such as a show of intimidation.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't find that here. So I'm not sure if real violence was happening to these people. And that,
all right. I mean, I am like 60% convinced. I mean, fair enough.
Yeah. And yeah. And so with the idea that these hats were kept around so that you have something from your relatives.
Mm-hmm.
Also makes light in the sense of this later skull cult that developed in the Levant of the Neolithic, where people took the heads of their beloved and put like plaster masks over them.
Oh.
Here are like these plastered skulls from Tel Aswad, which is today in Syria, mm-hmm. around the same time as Göbekli Tepe was being inhabited.
Okay, so if this was a benevolent thing, then I think chances are like it's far more likely that this was like an ancestor worship thing.
Yeah, there's some later that we will get encounter more signs that this skull cult wasn't as sinister as one would think. And yeah, with that, I want to give my food for thought. Like, why are there then so many headless statues all around these places? And my idea was maybe they actually put the heads of the relatives on top of these statues as a way of honoring them.
Oh!
And like I wrote here, probably nothing sinister going on here, just a way of keeping grandpa around and honoring him with a magnum dong.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of makes sense if you consider those very later Roman and ancient Greek tradition of building herms, which were like just a portrait of one person and like a pedestal and basically a dick where the guy is meant to have his dick. So maybe a primitive version of that. Exactly. Yeah, it could be. I mean, why not?
So, and yeah, from these like proto-Neolithic people, we come to the Neolithic proper when people start farming and keeping animals. And one of the most prominent settlements from that time is also in Turkey. It's called Çatalhöyük.
Yep.
And yeah, it's not the only type of settlement in Turkey that developed around this time, but it is the most prominent one because it was the largest.
And you know, there's some dark lore about the discoveries around Çatalhöyük, and some of them were forged, basically.
Oh no, I don't know what stories you mean.
Okay. So first let me let you describe Çatalhöyük, then I will step in with the deepest lore.
So what this could be called a proto-town, because there were a lot of people living very densely in a little space.
Mm-hmm.
But from all the archaeology, we can tell that all of the buildings were just domestic family homes. There was no palace, there were no temples, there were no administrative buildings. So
yep,
there was no ruling class, so to say. These were all people of the same standing, and mm-hmm. all of them were farmers.
Mm-hmm. But that's very interesting. Like a farming society without the harsh class structures we see in later farming societies.
Yeah, I mean, it is generally believed that the first farmers on Earth were all living in these egalitarian structures, and
mm-hmm.
the idea that you need administration only arose later when you needed someone who could determine, okay, this guy made more this year, this guy made less, let's give him more. You know, you needed someone to...
You think maybe it was even like a particular circumstance of the Nile Valley because of the flooding and stuff?
Yeah, exactly.
Ooh, okay. So,
like the idea, like the chiefs, the rulers and such, that arose from people needing to manage everything.
Mm-hmm.
So that no one would die of starvation.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, another interesting thing about Çatalhöyük here, I have found this artistic representation. There were no streets or paths. Instead, people walked over their rooftops and entered their houses through holes in the ceiling.
Do you think that was like an anti-leopard defense?
That could actually, like, we know that there were leopards living around here because they have been with the leopard skeletons have been given as grave presents in burials.
And so, if you have kids at home, like a baby or a woman or something, and like the man is out there farming, you know, it would probably make sense to keep the house safe like that.
Yeah, you are right, actually. That's a very good idea. And yeah, what is interesting is that no walls or any defensive structures have been found around this. Sorry.
People didn't fight each other as much, but...
Yeah, what I write here, like, there was no such thing as a war yet, you could say. There probably was nothing to fight a war about yet, because people had not accumulated any riches yet or any valuable resources, just food maybe.
Well, that's a big resource, but it looks like the rooftop thing was like definitely like an anti-leopard and maybe an anti-thief thing, and maybe at this day and age nobody living in the fringes of this society was like strong enough or organized enough to be a threat.
Yeah, that could definitely be it. And yeah, we find in these like a lot of religious symbolism that is related to what you found earlier in Göbekli Tepe, like a lot of representations of vultures, of leopards and aurochs. Like now domestic animals start showing up in art. Mm-hmm. And also deity figures, like here, this very famous figurine has been found in Çatalhöyük, the seated woman of Çatalhöyük.
Yeah, it's very clear to see this later became Kibele, the terrifying lady goddess.
Yeah. And you also found some traces of this skull cult again. So this is a woman that was buried with a plastered skull of someone else in her arms.
And oh yeah,
this is a very clear sign that these skulls meant something to people on a very deep emotional level.
Mm.
This was probably trying to keep around, like an attempt at keeping around a dead relative or just someone that you really cared about.
Okay, now that you've shown me, I think I'm convinced. I'm not nuking Göbekli Tepe anymore.
Reckless. And what else? And there is this minority opinion that the Indo-European language family actually originated in Neolithic Anatolian villages.
Oh.
Because the first attested Indo-European languages actually do show up in Anatolia later.
Mm-hmm.
A little later after this time, but this is a minority opinion because most signs instead point towards this language family developing in the Eurasian steppes, where today Ukraine or the Northern Caucasus is. But it's something interesting to think about.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Let me step in with like what I know about Göbekli Tepe. So Göbekli Tepe was first... Oh, sorry, Çatalhöyük, yes. Çatalhöyük was first excavated by this British archaeologist called Mellart, and it emerged like in 2010 or something, like in a very recent time. It emerged that he was actually like carefully mixing truth with fiction, and there used to be like a big relief at Göbekli Tepe, which was like entirely fabricated by him. He also mixed like real evidence with like completely faked artifact. So he was like really disgraced when this thing happened. And it's just like a cautionary tale in archaeology or about the British or both, really. And funny enough, I knew the grandson of this Mellart character, and they were from a very nice, very like very kind, smart, reputable people. And I did not speak with him, but it's just, I mean, not out of spite or anything, but after this thing broke out, I did not speak with my friend Mellart's grandson about this subject. And I can only wonder how, like, it must have made them feel. So yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a lot of questionable theories written about Çatalhöyük. For example, because of these female deity figures, there, for a long time, there was also these theories that this was a matriarchal society. So women ruled and there were only like female deities.
Mm-hmm.
But I think recent archaeology, it's not disproven, but there is also no strong evidence for it.
I don't think like a past society is going to be like, quote unquote, feminist in the way people understand today. There might be elements that render women like more powerful or give them more agency than some cultures in the ages that come after these ages. But I don't know if you can call it a matriarchy in a kind of contemporary feminist sense. I don't know.
If there was like no ruling class and no like lower class and people were egalitarian, I think that also extended towards genders. Probably men and women just worked equally as long on the fields and cared about each other and managed things.
Well, I don't know. I mean, like, you have to remember that in these ages, childcare is always a thing. Like,
that
so
is
like,
true, but that is true. But with food safety, also life expectancy was a bit heightened, and you could keep your grandparents around longer, and they could help you with raising your children.
Oh, true, true. I mean, once again, impossible to know for sure.
Yeah.
So I'm always like. Yes. I feel the same way about Minoan civilization too. Like these civilizations that kind of look idyllic, they still must have had some problems, but we just don't know. But what were they? It's just food for thought.
Yeah, I mean, in ages where overpopulation and resource depletion didn't exist yet, maybe there were idyllic societies. Who knows?
Yeah, could be.
But again, I wouldn't want to live in a world without modern medicine. Yeah. So the next interesting thing about Çatalhöyük is that possibly the oldest map in the world was found here, which is this depiction, which was found on the site, like drawn on a wall.
Yeah, so this is actually one of the artifacts that was somehow associated with this Mellart character.
Yeah.
So there are big debates about this, like whether it's a real map, whether it's just some interesting spots on the wall. Who knows?
Yeah, like in the map interpretation, like this colored patch you see here was like a volcano that did exist in real life close to this village. Mm-hmm. But it's also possible that this is like a stylized leopard skin.
Could be. Or it could be something as simple as a child's doodle, or I don't know, maybe people made it for the lulz. Who knows?
Neolithic memes, huh?
Not even a meme. It's just like playing with paint on a wall because there's no sense of contemporary aesthetics to stop you.
But could you imagine if we already had memes in the Neolithic or earlier? That would be hilarious.
I'm sure we had some, but.
Yeah, but like modern modern meme formats, you know.
Okay, that would be something.
So from the Neolithic, we now shift over to the metallic ages in Hachilar, you can find there is this settlement that has been inhabited from the 6th millennium BC all the way to the 4th.
Whoa.
And here you can actually like trace the development from the Neolithic into the Copper Age. So this was
unbelievable.
Yeah. So this started out as a settlement very similar to Çatalhöyük, mm-hmm. but over time you can see more structure developing, like, and also fortifications and temples being built, and more, and the art evolving, and even copper smelting arriving here.
It also seems to be like more linearly laid out, or is that just an artifact of the excavation?
I do think that's part of the walls.
Yeah.
Yeah, and here you also find these female figurines, which intriguing.
Oh yes, the big mamas coming into play again.
Yeah, and I always find this interesting because the faces, especially on the left guy here, remind me a bit of the Ubaid figurines from Mesopotamia.
Ah.
Which were made around the same time.
Looks like every city and town had their own kind of lady gods, and like in Mesopotamia, maybe they like skinnier, more reptilian chicks, and in Anatolia, they were like honking, chonking chonkers, but I don't know.
Before diet, after diet.
okay. Well, but the thing remains, like, if you go to any village in Anatolia, and there are these old, like fat, wise ladies sitting around, they're just so similar. It's just like you see the continuity. Maybe they're wearing clothes and not body paint, but like you have this like body type. And women like this are always very respected in traditional Turkish society. So I think there's like a direct continuity. Ana, they say. Ana, anam, anam, they say.
Yes, exactly. And yeah, like this growing importance of female deities in Anatolian culture. Mm-hmm. It is, like you said, probably what eventually would lead to the Kybele cult during the Iron Age.
I mean, a fat woman flanked with lions, they're like statues of Kybele that look exactly the same, so it wouldn't surprise me.
So, and around 3000 BC, the Kura Araxes culture enters Anatolia through the Caucasus, and that ends the Chalcolithic and starts the Bronze Age in the area.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And yeah, keep this culture in mind, we will come back to it later. So
okay.
After Hachilar, we come to the first, like, the definitive ethnicity we can talk about, the Hattians. After whom Hatti, like Bronze Age Anatolia, was named. And we unfortunately don't know much about these people. Like, most of what we know comes from the later Hittites, who took on their name and identity. But we know from the Hittites, you know, that the Hattians spoke a language that was neither Semitic nor Indo-European. It was an isolated language.
Oh, so like an indigenous Anatolian language.
Yes, though there have been some attempts to link it to Yeniseian, which is a language today spoken in Siberia, which is intriguing to think about how that...
It's my high school theory coming through. Second Turkish reconquest of Anatolia. I don't know.
I mean, Yeniseian isn't a Turkic language, so...
It was, though, in Siberia back in the day, no?
No, I think it's its own unique language.
Oh, okay.
Maybe it originated in the Caucasus, and that's maybe the connecting link. But yeah, this is, with cultures this old, there is nothing you can say definitive.
Exactly. I mean, I'll just go on to record by stating my skepticism. I mean, look, it's supremely interesting. Like, people really gloss over Hacılar. It's like, it's Hacılar, and it's like, but Göbekli Tepe and Çatalhöyük get all the spotlight. But just think about it. It's just like continually inhabited city for 2,000 years. And then they died out. And in our day and age, there are very few like cities that are that old. So imagine the kind of culture and like wisdom and local legends and folklore that must have developed around this place. It's just fascinating. And they were like technically sophisticated too. They saw the coming and going of several distinct like civilizational waves, maybe. I mean, out of every place we looked at so far, like Hacılar would be the one. If I was like forced at gunpoint to choose one of them to live in, this would be the one so far. So how about you, by the way?
I don't know. For some reason, Çatalhöyük always seems so cozy to me in these reconstructions.
Oh yeah, okay. These are fine too. Hacılar has the town though. Like you go downtown, you go to shops, you talk shop. I mean, I don't know. But I agree that Çatalhöyük is very cozy. You have your bull room and like sleep with... I think it's just there's something very like womb-like and cozy about living in a place with the door up top. So anyways.
So the Hattians, they were... So they arrived with the Bronze Age. I've almost forgot to say, like, I like to think that they did arise natively out of these earlier Chalcolithic and Neolithic cultures.
Mm-hmm.
And because there is a lot of continuity in, like, their visual language, in their religion.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. And the Hattians are important because not only did they give the land its name, but they also founded many cities that would later become important. They founded Hattusha, they founded Kanes, they founded Purushanda. And they, around these cities, they built city-states and even smaller kingdoms, which actually came into conflict with Sargon of Akkad, who unified Mesopotamia.
Carl Benjamin. I'm kidding.
We're talking about the competent Sargon.
The one
who actually will go down in history. So we know from some texts that Sargon directly went to war with this Hattian kingdom called Purushanda. And from that point on, Eastern Anatolia, which is basically just northern Mesopotamia, came directly under Sumerian rule, which also brought writing into Anatolia. And yeah, that lasted until the Akkadian kingdom itself was destroyed by the Gutians.
Who were the Gutians? They were from...
They were like mountain people from the Zagros, and that's all we can really say.
Just as a like interruption question, like which resources would you recommend people to read? Because like you obviously done some like very in-depth research, and like what I really admire about this whole talk is that you add your own like opinions and synthesis to talking points, which is like really nice. Like what resources would you recommend to people who want to study more?
There is this book you mentioned just yesterday in the live stream.
In the Land of a Thousand Gods by Christian Marek.
That is very good. And another book that has been useful to me is by Jörg Klinger, Die Hethiter. So this German book about the Hittite civilization. It also goes into detail about their previous, their predecessors and such. And I mean... Just online, you can also find a lot of fascinating things. You just have to be careful about what sources they use.
Yeah, and when synthesizing it. Yeah. But, I mean, I'm sure like anybody watching at this time, like, just type, thank you, TK Sivgin. So we beat the algorithm. And we also appreciate like the great effort you put into this. Because once more, I'm sure there's some videos about this floating around on YouTube, but nothing this comprehensive so far. And considering we are just a bunch of like semi-amateur interesting guys dabbling about with this. It's like a really great contribution. So a mad respect once again.
Yeah. Also check out Memo's, what was it? OnlyFans? No, Patreon.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, what I find interesting about the Hattian religion is that they basically take all of these totem animals that we saw earlier in the Neolithic and they personify them into distinct deities. They had this storm god called Taru, which was represented with a bull. And just look at these bulls and compare with these mounted bull skulls in Çatalhöyük.
Oh, also, I wonder if there's any link between the name Taru and the word Taurus, which comes
later. Yeah, I mean, there could very well be a link. And yeah, also the leopard becomes the sun goddess Vurunsemu, and all these Venus figurines, they finally get a name as Kataha, and later also Anita and such. Uh-huh. Yeah, and these god deities then become also part of the Hittite pantheon later on. And from the Hittite pantheon, they kind of go also have an influence on Greek mythology and such, and we will get to that later.
All righty.
But it is really interesting to see the development. Like, at the beginning in these tepes, you have only these male schlong figures. Mm-hmm. Then the Neolithic women finally show up in religious imagery. And now by the early Bronze Age, you have female deities finally showing up with names.
Oh, yeah, the evolution of language.
Visual
it's
language.
Just, yeah, the evolution of gods. And it's just fascinating. Also, a point worth always noting is that, like, in a society when there are, like, female gods, it doesn't always mean that women were in a higher status. Because, I mean, judging from some contemporary Christian religious expressions, in lots of Catholic countries, the Virgin Mary is a distinct figure, but certain reproductive rights for women were extremely hard to obtain in those countries. So always note that, like, deification does not always equal empowerment.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
very well said. Like, the best example is, like, all the female deities in Greek mythology, like Athena, compared to the actual attitude of women that towards women that the Greeks had, which is
honestly,
which was honestly worse than what you see today in Arabic countries like Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, I mean, a famous author, John Dolan, once said, without much hyperbole, that he said, like, Afghanistan is the last true country in which Alexander the Great's ethic holds true, which is like the complete seclusion of women and, like, basically a weird, unacknowledged homoerotic caste applied to men. But anyways.
Yeah. Rule number one. From the Hattians, we also come to the Hurrians, who were very important in the east of this area. And these were also mountain people that spoke an isolated language.
Mm-hmm.
And they were in frequent contact with the Mesopotamian people and also probably influenced them in some ways. For example, thought that the Sumerian word for copper actually comes from the Hurrian language.
Ah.
Hurrians maybe brought copper smelting into Mesopotamia. And yeah, the Hurrians, they were a very successful, let's say, ethnicity. Because, like, you can see by the dates, they survived for a very long time as a distinct culture and language.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, they, starting at Urkesh, they spread all across the Middle East and founded many kingdoms and even some empires.
Without getting much into rule one, sometimes in the present day, some of these cultures, especially Hurrians, are linked to Kurdish people, and they're kind of like postulated as proto-Kurds. Do you have anything to say on this matter, or should we not even go there?
At least linguistically, it doesn't, like, I mean, I can, I see why that would make sense from the areas, but linguistically speaking, the Hurrians, like, Kurdish is, if I remember correctly, a descendant of Iranian languages, so within the Indo-European family tree. Mm-hmm. So linguistically, that doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. What makes more sense is the theory that the Kurds are somehow linked to the Parthians, who were an Iron Age culture that ruled what is today Iran and all the Mesopotamia. So I think that makes more sense to link Kurds to the Parthians.
I see.
But these are, again, like, very highbrow discussions, and they will gather some controversy. Like, let's move on.
Okay.
Hurrian incense goat. Like, come on, man. This is more important.
Oh yes, this is the most important relic in the world. Just look at it. It's so cute.
Yeah.
Does it have like different floors for different kinds of incense burning? Like,
I guess in the bottom you put in like the wood and the fire, and on top you put the incense, and then.
I mean, it just looks like a very fancy, you know, luxury item, like a big flat screen TV. Or like one of those high-end stereos in the contemporary day and age.
It reminds me of Howl's Moving Castle for some reason.
true.
Yeah.
And the goat is just adorable.
Yes. And yeah, from the Hurrians, you also have the oldest piece of notated music. So this is the hymn to Nikkal, and this was found in a town in Assyria. And it is for like this upper section, that is the song text, and below that, below this line, you have instructions for how you're supposed to play it on a lyre, and so that's able to reconstruct what this music sounded like.
Can we maybe add this in post-production?
You bet your ass I will do that.
Okay, so yeah, enjoy the music, everybody. And thank the bygone Hurrians for this amazing banger tunes.
Yeah, this. What I really like about this is it's been reused a lot in the Civilization games when they try to make music for like old Mesopotamian factions. Yeah. And yeah, another fun fact about the Hurrians, their language may have inspired a bit J.R.R. Tolkien. It's like in Mordor, they have their own language called the Black Speech, and the only piece of Black Speech we know about is the inscription on the One Ring, you know, one ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the
darkness bind them.
Yeah, and there was this Russian linguist, I don't know his name anymore, who pointed out that some of these words are actually very similar in sound and meaning to words from the Hurrian language. And when Tolkien was writing The Lord of the Rings, the Hurrian language was just being deciphered, and he was a linguist, so of course he would have known about this, and he would have probably been fascinated by it.
Isn't it crazy? Like, in this day and age, we have channels like Bibla Ridion, who is a great alien designer and also a great designer of Konglangs, which are like these fancy imagined languages. Like, it's so what fascinates me is that some niche hobby that would have only been available to like J.R.R. Tolkien right now, in this day and age, thanks to the internet, thousands of people can like enjoy it. It's still maybe not extremely popular, but it still is like a nice, fun hobby and like great speculative art that many smart people around the world get to partake. So, and when I like notice tidbits like that, I always imagine like how many people like J.R.R. Tolkien must have just like wasted away in the corners of life just because they did not have access to education or communication tools. And it's just one of the reasons we gotta appreciate some of the nice things we have today. So there.
Yeah, very well said. Yeah, what I found interesting about this connection is that there is some interview, I think, where Tolkien said that if you were to project the map of Middle-earth onto real Earth, where the hobbits live, there would be Britain and... are you okay there? I think the sound quality just...
dipped. No, I'm okay. I'm okay. Okay. It might be an artifact of the time. And
yeah, because I started hearing my own voice. So what I want to say is like there is an interview where Tolkien says if you were to project the map of Middle-earth onto a real map, then latitude-wise, the Shire would be where Great Britain is, and Gondor is where Greece is, and Mordor would be Asia Minor. And yeah.
I think it's no secret that Tolkien was, if not a Turcophobe, he actually like did not have the best opinion of people living in this part of the world. Let me say that much. The whole like likening of orcs to Turks and like the siege of Helm's Deep to the siege of Vienna and stuff like that, which okay is fair. I mean, he's writing about European civilization and it is what it is, but like it's no surprise. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, for clarification, he didn't directly compare orcs to Turks, but I think in the first description they are said to have like the most ugliest of mongoloid features. And
yeah, and also the name is just like kind of echoes the name, but
No. Orc is like a term from like Irish mythology or Anglo-Saxon mythology for some like monster that was slain by Beowulf.
Oh, okay. So my bad.
Yeah, I wouldn't think too deeply about this. I don't think Tolkien was spending too much thought on these things.
Okay. Yeah. You're right.
Yeah. So we first have the Huttians and Hurrians, and intermingling among them were now all of these Assyrian merchants who were building their own trade outposts outside of these Huttian and Hurrian towns.
Cue Trade Federation music from Star Wars Episode 1.
Yeah. So these outposts, they're called Karum.
Mm-hmm.
We find so many clay tablets where these merchants just talk about their contracts, but also about their personal life and their businesses, and it's surprisingly very modern.
Like nothing new under the sun.
Yeah, like everyone knows about this Ea Nasir.
Ea Nasir, the chat.
These here are a bit older than those clay tablets from Ea Nasir, but they are very similar in tone. Like it's very modern, complaining about business deals, about contracts, but they also talk about having trouble with their children and marital problems.
Yeah.
And what is interesting is that they, all these tablets also through names record the arrival of the first Hittite and Luwian people arriving in Anatolia. So, and this wasn't,
so that's very interesting, because I always assumed Hittites actually came before the Assyrians, but it just goes to show how ignorant I am.
It all kind of happened around the same. Like this is the area that forms the core of the Hittite Empire. You see Hattusa here in the middle, not far off from Ankara, actually. And here you have Kanes, for example, Kültepe, was originally founded by Hattian people and then became a prominent trading outpost to Assyria. And the Hittites actually traced their ancestry not to Hattusa, but to Kanes, which they called Nessa.
I've got to ask you,
what was the main item of trade for like the Assyrian trading empire? Like,
Ding.
Oh, okay.
So man. Anatolia was rich in very rich in mineral resources, like gold, silver, and copper, while Mesopotamia had a lot of textiles and such, and so that's how this trade went.
Ah, very nice, very timely. And I swear I did not realize this slide was there, and it was an original, like, so very nice flow on this whole presentation.
Yeah, and here you see also, and this will become important later, tin. And now that we are in the Bronze Age, bronze is not a naturally occurring mineral, but it's an alloy that you get by mixing copper with tin.
Mm-hmm.
And copper is fairly common, but tin is very rare, a very rare mineral that you can find only in certain places on Earth, like the British Isles or Iran or Central Asia.
Mm-hmm.
And so already in the early Bronze Age, you have all of these almost globalized trade networks building themselves up so that people can produce bronze. And yeah, keep that in mind later, because this will become important in the downfall of the Bronze Age. So, like I already mentioned, now around this time, let's say 2000 BC, Luwians and Hittites start appearing in Anatolia. There's some signs that they maybe were around 4000 BCE. And these are all Indo-European people. And of course, the classic interpretation was that around this time, there was this like big migration and or invasion happening of these Indo-European people all around the Eurasia.
Yeah, but, yeah.
Like I said, in these Assyrian records, these people are mentioned only by the way. So like in, so some guy mentions that he traded with a guy named Mursili and such, and that's how we even know these people first start showing up as just common people in these Hattian cities, just slowly intermingling with the native people.
I mean, it's this kind of movement from periphery to the center.
Exactly. I mean, so
it wasn't like a bloody barbarian invasion.
Yeah.
Like nothing like the Mongol invasion or something, right?
Yeah, it was more, yeah, like you said, maybe actually like an economic migration. So people were coming to these cities for money, like monetary reasons. Well, not monetary, like currency didn't exist yet, but for material reasons.
Yeah.
And not
yeah.
yet as conquerors. And of course, but some people don't know that there was this entire language branch within Indo-European of just Anatolian languages.
Oh, yes.
And you see,
I love these things so much, and like so little is known about them.
Yeah. And yeah, Hittite is the oldest one, like the most primitive one of these we know. It is also the oldest known Indo-European language.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have Palaic, which was spoken in the north. Here, then Lydian, that will become important in the Iron Age, and then you have this whole language family called Luvic, Lycian, Sidetic, Pisidian, and of course Luvian descent. And some of these actually survived very far, like already, like during the age of Hellenism, there were still people in Side speaking this strange language, and
I remember Lycian speakers.
Yeah, and some Greek authors comment on that, how these people are like speaking strange native languages, and yeah, this entire branch became extinct because of the Hellenization of Anatolia, but some words and phrases still survive in Greek.
Such as, do you know any examples?
I know, for example, the Hittite word for ivory became the Greek word for ivory. But I don't know what the word actually was.
Yeah, but this is fantastic. And have all of these languages been deciphered? Like, or we just know that some exist and like we just don't know much about them. How's that go?
I mean, yeah, for them to have a name, I guess they have all been deciphered to some degree. Like, yeah, we know Hittite, we know Lydian, Luvian, Lycian.
And
yeah, so like we have textual evidence from these. And
there
were also some that we don't have any evidence for. Like we don't know much about how Lydian is related to these others, other than that it's an Anatolian language. So there probably were some intermediaries that we have not found yet.
I see.